Hey, I'm Dave. Welcome to my shop. I'm Dave Plummer, a retired operating systems engineer going back to the MS-DOS and Windows 95 days, and today we're diving deep into the performance of the new 5950X, which serves as the basis for a new Windows and Linux PC for my own little Oval Office. It's the current king of the hill, and we'll be drag racing it against the 3970X core for core to see just how fast they actually are. I'll tell you right now that the old king still beats the new king even in some single core cases. We'll take a look at what those are, how we discovered them, and what they mean, all right now on Dave's Garage. Now, before we get underway, I'd like to ask you to take a moment to subscribe to the channel if you've not done so already. Subscribing is really just a vote of confidence in the channel and a little burst of dopamine for me. And don't forget to stop by the merchandise store to grab a fancy Dave's Garage mug, with all the profits going to autism research. And now, back to the story of the 5950X. My house has an oval office, and in that oval office is an oval desk, and in that oval desk is what used to be my main PC before I started working out here in the shop so much. I built this machine about 8 years ago, way back in 2013, and it's organized around an i7-4770K. It does have what is an astounding amount of memory for the time at 32 gigabytes. I don't use that computer as often as I used to, but one day when I did need it, I found that it wouldn't turn on anymore. Other than the various LEDs, the system was completely dead. I didn't think it was worth troubleshooting an 8-year-old motherboard, so I decided to treat myself by upgrading. The problem is that the CPU I would want, the current king of the streets, is the AMD 5950X. And the 5950X is still, as of today at least, very hard to get. If and when you do find one available for sale, odds are it will be at some outrageously inflated and second sticker price, and I didn't want to get caught up in some wave of irrational exuberance while building a PC. Since this is something of a secondary desktop for me right now, I decided to bide my time and wait it out until the CPU would come around to me. Well, it turns out I didn't have to wait too long. A fellow I'd worked with way back in the Windows NT days was also searching for 5950X, but he was doing it much more aggressively, even trying to score one through the Newegg lottery system. Eager to get one, he ordered from multiple sources, and as is almost guaranteed to happen when you do so, multiple CPUs showed up. Which vendors they ultimately came from, I've forgotten as this isn't a sponsored video, but having two in hand meant that he had an extra, and I was eager to snap up the opportunity for the spare CPU at MSRP. I quickly did so, thanked him, and then set out to buy the rest of the components that I would need. This was a fairly simple build to spec out because right now there are some clear performance winners, so you don't have to agonize over which components to select. To wit, the 5950X is the fastest single-core CPU that can run Intel code, and so to complement it, I went with the fastest SSD that I was able to source, the Samsung 980 Pro, which will do some 7 gigabytes per second. I stepped up to 64 gig of G.Skill RAM rated at 3600 MHz. And finally, I needed a robust motherboard to tie it all together. For a decade or more, I've been something of an ensues snob when it came to motherboards. After all, they're both heart-touching and rock-solid, well, at least according to their slogan. This was not from any particular loyalty to or affinity with that brand so much as the fact that they just seemed to have the slightly higher end boards that offered the features I was looking for. This year, however, everything I've built has been based on Gigabyte Aorus boards. That's primarily because some of my main criteria are that I'd have 10 gig networking on board and have lots of slots free. I'd had fairly good luck with and been impressed with the quality of Gigabyte Aorus Xtreme on my TRX 40 build, and so that's the way I went again. The current chipset that you want for the 5950X is the X570, and so the board I ultimately selected was the Gigabyte Aorus X570 Xtreme. In addition to the 10 gigabit NIC that I mentioned, it has serious overkill on the power VRMs, a great audio system, and three PCI 4M2 slots with good thermal packaging. And this thing is built like a tank. It's not cheap at $700, but it's one of those rare expensive products where at least it's pretty clear where your money went. They did not cut many corners. With all the parts in hand, I swapped everything over into the case, put the SSDs in the mainboard, and got it ready to start up. When I was done building, I double and triple checked everything, and it all looked good, so I plugged in the power cord and threw the switch. Nothing. Well, not exactly nothing, but nothing other than the fan LEDs lit up. Just like the old i7. So I ran it by my wife. You know, she said it was probably the power supply, and likely had been all along. It turns out she was right, and I guess it turns out that I really didn't need all these fancy new components. I probably just needed a new power supply. Oh well, live and learn. So they're here now, so let's have a quick look at the results of the build with a little montage I made. I haven't been able to find a nice braided cable kit for the Gigabyte power supply, so if you know of one, please shout it out in the comments. As you're watching this montage, there's a progress bar that will tick down on the left-hand side that you can use the chapter advance if you get bored, but it's less than a minute, so I hope you enjoy. When everything was done and ready, I plugged it in to do some benchmarking. With that many DOS blinking lights, it better be fast, and I was not disappointed. My first quick smoke test is usually to run CPU Z and then tab over to the benchmarking page. It contains a simple little test of CPU performance. Here's a quick example of CPU Z running on the 3970 on the left and the 5950X on the right. The 3970 scores 500 in single core and 20,000 in multi-core. That means its 32 cores plus hyper-threading achieve the equivalent of 40 cores of work. That surprised me. As you can see, the 5950X has the better single-core score by about 30%. At 11,800, the multi-core score is about 50% of what we see with the 3970. CPU-Z can generate charts to show your relative performance given performance standards. The next fastest chip on their chart is the 10900K, and it's a solid 10% slower on every core, and remember, only features 10 cores versus our 16. We can see that the 3950X score is 524, and that's also about where the 3970 scores as well. So from there, we can turn our attention to the multi-core results. The most direct competitor is the 3950X, the older generation of this 16-core chip. Chip for chip, the 5950X is about 8% faster than the outgoing generation under maximum workload. For comparison, the 3970X scores 21,000, a solid 45% improvement from having 50% more cores. With those quick tests out of the way, we know that things are working fundamentally correctly, and we can turn our attention to some more advanced benchmarking. One test that I've come to rely on is called Geekbench. For reasons that confuse and anger me, the Linux version is slightly faster than the Windows version, except for my very best run, which was on Windows, so that's what I'm going to run, Linux. And it's still faster than the Windows subsystem, and its perf numbers are dead to nuts accurate against the 5950X leaderboards at the Geekbench website. I installed Ubuntu 20.04 LTS on the 3970, but couldn't get it to run to completion. It would blow up with either out-of-memory error or an I.O. error in the late stages of the multicore test, and I wasn't able to solve it in time for the episode. However, if you compare the WSL2 numbers to other people's bare metal numbers on Geekbench, you can see that I'm actually slightly faster than the average for the 3970X under Linux. Whatever performance penalty there must be then appears to be very tiny. Let's have a look at the 3970X Geekbench run. The 3950X looks the same, of course, except for the numbers, so I won't repeat showing it here. To run the benchmark, you've got to download the archive from the Geekbench website. Then, to unpack it, all I did was gunzip it and then tar xvf it into a folder. That produces a standard Linux binary called Geekbench x86-64 that you can execute to run the benchmark. In the System Information panel, you can see that this chip has 32 cores, 64 threads, and a base clock of 3.7 GHz, and tons of cache memory, which will be important later on. It has 32K of L1 cache, 512K of L2 cache, and 128 megabytes of L3 cache. The Geekbench benchmark runs all of its tests twice, once on a single core only, and then again across all cores. Although I'm curious how the 5950X will do, I'm confident that with twice as many cores, this 3970X will handily best it in multi-core performance. But it's the single core speed that I'm most curious about. It's supposed to have come a long way with this new generation of chip, and a more advanced workload might show even more improvement than the simple CPU-Z test did. I'll fast forward through the benchmarks so we can get you to the end of the results. As I do, you'll see it doing things such as text and image compression, web work, compiler test, physics, image and graphics tests, and even HDR, ray tracing, and machine learning, so it's a pretty cool mix of tests. When it's done both single and multi-core variant testing, it produces results. The multi-core score on the 3970X jumped from 23,000 to 27,000 under WSL2, which blew me away, so I ran it again to verify, and it's true. Single-core speed of the 3970X saw a best of 1368. The 5950X produced a best of 1781. That's even higher than the 1732 we saw with the Apple M1, the previous king of the street when it came to Geekbench racing. For multi-core, even though the 5950X has only half the cores of the 3970, it turned in 60% of the perf of the 3970 with a best of 16494 versus the latter's 27211. If I remember correctly, that's the same performance ratio we got from the CPU-Z test. Now, I don't want to get too far afield into the Primes project, as folks like Rolf and Rutger and Tudor have worked hard enough on it that it absolutely deserves the focus of at least a dedicated episode or two. Still, I wanted to run my beloved Civ on the new chip and see how much faster it was, core for core, than the old Threadripper. What happened next confused the heck out of me. Core for core, even on a single core at once, the old 3970 Threadripper was still faster than the blazing new 5950X. Even though all the benchmarks pegged the new chip as 10 to 30% faster on each core, for the real-world problem of solving primes, it just wasn't true. This new chip was actually 5 to 6% slower. One of the reasons it's been longer between videos is that I sort of rat-holed for the better part of a week trying to sort this issue out. The most likely theory came from a fellow named Oliver online, and that was that the Threadripper has twice the cache memory that the 5950 does. That makes a huge difference, since the Prime Civ is primarily memory-based, and therefore very sensitive to cache misses. I ran a ton of tests, all designed to vary the size of the sieve and see what the correlation to performance was. I tried varying the number of threads, then a single thread, then locking it to 16 threads per chip, and so on. I documented everything in an Excel spreadsheet and then started graphing things. What I found confirmed the theory. The new chip is faster for small sieves, and the old chip, with its much bigger cache, is more adept at handling the bigger sieves. The inflection point seems to be a cache size of around 500 million. That's where the 3970X takes over. These margins are small, of course, about 5% at most, but if I'm going to explain away why a new chip should be expected to be slower in some cases, I figure I should at least back that up with a theory and some data. So there you have it. The 5950X is up to 10 to 30% faster core for core in mixed benchmarks and up to 5% slower when it comes to some very specific large memory model tasks. In day-to-day use, however, there's no denying that you can really feel the improvement in single-core performance in these mixed workloads. It's an incredibly snappy system. Thanks for joining me out here in the shop today. If you've enjoyed this episode at all, as I said, please take a moment to subscribe to the channel if you would. And if there's somewhere appropriate that you could share this video, please do so. If you found it interesting, odds are folks that you know might as well, so a share from someone like yourself who liked it is really valuable, and I'd appreciate it accordingly. In the meantime, and in between time, I hope to see you next time, right here in Dave's Garage.